Recorded Books presents Fatal Flowers by Jess Dillon, narrated by Sandy Rustin. Look before you leap, for snakes among sweet flowers creep. English proverb. Chapter 1. The camera stared at me like a one-eyed robot, cold and unblinking. I stared back. The modern, bullet-shaped contraption was out of place, anachronistic even, under the painted eaves of the century-old Victorian. Flower House was welcoming and cheerful, the front porch overflowing with barrels and boxes of many-hued flowers. The security camera was the opposite. I wrinkled my nose at the thing and stuck out my tongue. Feeling sassy, I also wiggled my hips in a childish dance of defiance. A feminine voice crackled from an invisible speaker. It works, no need to put on a show. I froze, then giggled. I'd almost forgotten there were people on the other side of the camera. My friend Dina was inside at the computer in our small office, along with the security company tech, who had installed the front camera and its twin above the back door, as well as burglar alarms on all the windows. Good, I replied. Now we can finally check this item off our to-do list. This task had been hanging over my head for far too long. Most business owners would have invested in a security system after the first break-in, which followed the first murder on the premises last spring. I cringed at the recollection, as well as the word first. There had been a second murder a few short months later. Intruders, vandals, killers. We'd had them all in the short span of time since I'd taken charge of the shop. Not that it was my fault. It was purely coincidental. The incidents at Flower House very well could have happened when my old boss Felix was still in charge. And how different would things be then? If Felix hadn't decided to retire and leave his shop to me, all so he could go gallivanting off on a fanciful treasure hunt out west, I might be the one traveling the country, chasing my own dreams. I'd wanted to be a singer-songwriter, carrying the spirit of my Appalachian roots in my heart as I sang my way to the big time. Instead, my heart and my voice remained firmly planted in my hometown, where my roots only sank deeper. Dina emerged from the front door with a security technician, a freckle-faced young man in a company jacket. As he handed me a pen and a clipboard, he tried, unsuccessfully, to hide an amused smirk. I signed the contract and returned the pen with the bat of my eyelashes. Thank you, sir, I said brightly. He handed me a business card. Call if you have any questions, day or night. Oh, I will, I assured him. Dina chuckled as the guy walked away, toward his car on the street. Is there anyone left in this town that you haven't charmed to pieces? I ignored her comment and pointed at the camera. It's like an evil eye, isn't it? If Granny's protection charms don't keep the bad guys away, this camera ought to. That's the idea, she agreed. It's also like insurance. We may never need it, but it's worth it for the peace of mind. Especially for Calvin, I said. Not that he ever complained. Calvin was a former botany professor who had shown up here out of the blue last spring at Felix's invitation, except Felix, the scatterbrain, had forgotten and skipped town. Calvin stayed anyway and turned out to be a godsend. He'd rented the upstairs apartment and accepted a job taking care of the greenhouse out back, not to mention helping out with anything and everything else that needed doing in the shop. True, said Dina. I still don't know how he could sleep at night. It never seemed to faze him that so much mayhem happened in the shop below his apartment. She gave me a sidelong glance. Speaking of Calvin, have you heard from him lately? Yeah, I got a text a couple days ago. He still says he's coming back, sometime soon. Good, said Dina. She opened her mouth as if to say more, then scrapped the thought. I better go get the cafe ready. The garden club will be here for their monthly meeting in less than an hour. That's today? I'll come help in a minute. I want to freshen the blooms out here. I moved absently toward the porch display and picked up a watering can. Lately, the mention of Calvin had been throwing me into a pensive mood. He'd been gone for a little more than a month, and the idea that he might not return bothered me more than I cared to admit. Calvin Foxheart. I felt a grin tug at my lips in spite of myself. His name suited him. He was cute and kind of nerdy, yet brave and strong, too. Biting my lip, I pinched off a dried orange marigold blossom and crumbled the seeds onto the soil. There was a time when I wasn't sure if I could trust Calvin. Eventually, though, he'd proven to be a true friend. And then some. Our growing attraction to each other was undeniable. I gazed into space as the memories replayed themselves in my mind. We'd begun spending more time with each other, both at the shop and outside of work. It was fun to get to know him better. I enjoyed his company and loved the way I felt when he was near. In fact, we would have become even closer if not for a series of thwarted opportunities. It was almost comical, all the times we'd been interrupted or distracted at the exact moment we might have shared our first kiss. Whether it was an ill-timed thunderstorm, an important phone call, or a murderer in our midst, there was always something coming between us. Most recently, it was Calvin's family, who needed his help on their farm in Iowa while his father recovered from hip surgery. I kept telling myself we'd surely laugh about all the interruptions someday. I tried to ignore the irrational voice in my head, the one that wondered if the universe was conspiring to keep us apart. "Ridiculous," I muttered. It was just life being life. Unpredictable, messy, and inconvenient at times, in between all the magic and beauty. A car door slammed shut, pulling me from my daydreams. I hadn't even heard a car drive up, but that might have been because the motor was so quiet. If I wasn't mistaken, the snappy red vehicle along the curb was a Mercedes-Benz. The young woman walking toward me was dressed in a matching beige skirt and sweater set, an outfit that suited someone with such an expensive car. So did her perfectly styled straight golden hair and model-worthy makeup. She gave me a friendly smile when she spotted me on the porch, but as she got closer, I saw that the smile didn't quite reach her eyes. The telltale lines spoke instead of worry and sadness. "Howdy," I said. "Welcome to Flower House. Are you here for the garden club meeting?" Her eyes flickered in confusion. "No, I was hoping to speak with someone about wedding flowers." I set down the watering can and wiped my hands on my corduroys. "Well, absolutely, come on in, miss." I trailed off in a questioning tone. "Marissa," she supplied. "Nice to meet you, Marissa. I'm Sierra Ravenswood, the owner and manager here." It still felt funny to identify myself in that way, but I figured the more I said it, the sooner it might feel natural. I directed Marissa across the foyer that opened to the shop floor, then to the left, through the arched entryway that led to the cafe room. Decorated in a charming French provincial style, with polished antique furniture, a crystal chandelier, a plush velvet sofa, and painted vases bursting with sensual bouquets in every corner, the cafe had become an attractive destination for individuals and groups alike. The monthly garden club was one of the regular meetings that took place here. Dina had already pushed together three small tables in the seating area next to the front window, so I chose a table near the bakery case. "Would you like coffee or tea?" I offered. "No, thank you." She spoke quietly, which had the effect of requiring her listener's full attention. Or maybe she was used to being discreet. "You sure?" I asked. "We have some nice specialty teas, calming lavender chamomile, soothing ginger lemon." I didn't know why, but I had a feeling she could use a touch of comfort. Perhaps it was the way she kept twisting her engagement ring, which, incidentally, featured the biggest diamond I'd ever seen this up close and personal.
"Actually, that does sound nice," she said. "I'll have lavender chamomile."
Dina had overheard and appeared beside us with teacups and a miniature kettle of hot water. As she handed me a jar of honey, I noticed her eyebrows quirk expressively above her shining brown eyes. Was she trying to tell me something? I returned my attention to Marissa, who was pouring water over the tea in her cup. I started to push back from the table. I'll go grab our wedding portfolio and bouquet catalogs. Be back in a jiffy. It might have been a stretch to call our slim binder of photos a portfolio, but Dina and I were optimistic, and I believed in the law of attraction. If you want to attract more wedding jobs, act as a wedding florist would act. At the moment, our collection included more prom corsages and anniversary bouquets than bridal photos, but it was a start. Marissa held out a hand to stop me.
You don't need to do that.
I paused. Oh, okay, you already know what you want. Dina returned to the table with a plate of daisy-shaped sugar cookies sprinkled with bits of edible flower petals. Again, she appeared uncommonly excited about something. Probably it was the prospect of landing a wedding client. Dina, I said, would you do me a favor and grab our price sheet? Marissa shook her head dismissively.
I don't care about the cost.
Now Dina and I exchanged a glance. It dawned on me that she must recognize Marissa. This wasn't a surprise. Aerieville was a small town, and Dina had always been more social than I was, back in high school and even now, a decade later.
I'll get you a notebook, Dina offered.
Thanks. As Dina left the cafe, I stirred my tea and asked the obvious question. So, Marissa, when is your wedding?
September 27th.
I nodded. Lovely. Fall weddings are so beautiful, and since it will be around this time next year, you can see what's in season now and take inspiration from what's currently blooming.
It's not next year, she corrected.
Oh, it's 2 years out?
No. 2 weeks, September 27th, this year.
I dropped my spoon and stared. I almost asked if she was joking, but it was clear she wasn't.
I know it's short notice, but I'm prepared to pay a premium and any extra charges. Or I should say, my parents will.
She touched the edge of a cookie.
Pretty,
she murmured. I wasn't sure what to say. I wanted to ask why she was in such a rush to get married, but I knew that would be rude. Maybe her fiancé was in the military and would be leaving for a tour of duty. Or maybe she was expecting. In fact, this wouldn't be the first last-minute wedding job I'd handled. I knew it could be done. It was unusual and challenging, but it wasn't impossible. She took a sip of tea, then resumed fidgeting with her ring.
The wedding and reception will be at my parents' house, and we'll need decorations for both. The colors are cranberry and gold. The last florist designed my bouquet with calla lilies and roses, but you don't have to stick with that.
The last florist?
We had another florist, but she backed out.
Marissa's eyes slid toward the window.
I'm not sure why.
I heard the front door jingle, followed by the drift of voices from the foyer. It sounded like Dina was greeting the garden club members. Marissa pushed back her chair. Was she leaving already?
How large is the wedding party? I asked. And how many guests are you expecting?
She reached into her purse, then handed me a business card and stood up.
Taz will give you all the details. He's the wedding planner.
I glanced at the card and the bold-lettered name. Taz Banyan, Nashville, Tennessee. Before returning my confused gaze to Marissa.
I began, but she interrupted. You'll do it, won't you?
I was hoping to use a local florist at least, since all the other vendors are from out of town. Like I said, money is no object. As I looked into her pleading eyes, I felt a strange sense of inevitability wash over me. As odd as this encounter was, and as stressful as the job might be, I knew I couldn't say no. Of course, I didn't want to turn down any business, but it was more than that. This was a woman in need, and where there was need, I had the urge to help.
Yes, I said with a brief nod. We'll do it.
We were so busy the rest of the morning, I had to put Marissa out of my mind. Between serving the garden club ladies in the cafe and helping a couple of walk-in customers, we had online flower orders to fill. Mondays weren't always this busy. Then again, birthdays, anniversaries, and get-well wishes could happen anytime, and every day was a good day for flowers. When Felix was in charge, he didn't bother much with advertising or promotions. He was content to run a slow business, since it gave him more time for his hobbies. When I took over, I soon realized such a lax business model wasn't sustainable. With help from Dina and Calvin, I decided to open the flower-themed cafe in the hopes that it would draw in more customers. It worked, and we became busier than ever. I was already thinking of hiring more staff when Calvin announced he had to go away for a while. As luck would have it, around the same time, my grandmother told me about a family she knew who had come upon hard times. The single mother had been laid off, and her older kids were looking for work. That's how I came to meet Toby and Allie Johnson. All summer, Toby, 19, made deliveries for us and took care of yard work. Allie, aged 17, worked the cash register and kept the shop floor tidy. They were good kids, if a little too timid. I wrapped up a delivery for Toby and told him to take a lunch break before coming back. Then I walked up front, where Allie was wiping down the checkout counter. Her dishwater blonde hair was pulled back in a headband, making her look even younger than she was. "It's lunchtime, Allie. I can mind the register while you go eat."
"That's okay, Miss Ravenswood. I'm not hungry, thank you, though."
"Well, take a break anyway. Why not go outside and get some fresh air?" Dina poked her head out of the cafe. "Anyone want a watercress and chive blossom sandwich? We have a few left over, and they're best eaten fresh." "If Gus were here, he'd be happy to help you out," I joked. My young corgi loved to eat, and he wasn't picky. He was usually a fixture at Flower House, charming customers or hanging out in the office. He also liked to be at the center of all activity, which meant he was often underfoot. That was why I dropped him off with my brother Rocky before meeting the security tech at the shop this morning. Allie was biting her lip as she eyed the sandwich tray. I gave her a nudge. "Help yourself, Allie. You need to eat."
"Well, okay, that sounds good. Maybe I'll take it to the park down the street."
"Good idea." Dina wrapped up some sandwiches while I poured iced tea into a thermos. Allie gratefully accepted both with a promise to be back soon. After she left the shop, I glanced out the window. "She's such a shrinking violet, isn't she?" Dina wrinkled her nose at my pun, making me grin. My thoughts of Calvin must have put his goofy sense of humor into my consciousness. "How can we boost her confidence?"
"We could give her more responsibilities," said Dina,
"which we'll have to do if we get the Lakely wedding."
"Lakely? As in Mayor Lakely?"
Dina shook her head.
"I knew you didn't recognize her. That was Marissa Lakely you were talking with this morning."
"Oh, that makes sense. She mentioned her wedding is taking place at her parents' house. The mayor lives in a mansion, doesn't he?"
"Yes, but that's because of who his wife is. Marissa's mother is Annalise Bellman, of the Bellman family."
She gave me a questioning look.
"Right. They're in real estate, aren't they?"
I probably should have known these things, but I'd been away from town since high school and only moved back at the beginning of the year, and I'd been a bit preoccupied ever since.
"Real estate, land development, and a few other enterprises. They're only the wealthiest family in Aerieville. It would really up our profile if we got to provide the flowers for that wedding. But they'll probably go with a larger florist."
"Actually, we did get the job, but there's a catch." I told Dina about the 2-week turnaround. Her shock quickly turned to skepticism.
"You probably misunderstood."
"I don't think so." Part of me was hoping I had. The enormity of the commitment I'd made was finally starting to sink in. Of course, I hadn't signed a contract, but I had given my word. I found the wedding planner's business card and showed it to Dina. "I guess I'd better call him now."
"Please do."
She handed me a pen and a pad of paper. The front door jingled as a customer came in, so I headed to our small office down the hall. Formerly a den,
The cozy room still felt more like a gentleman's study than a business office. I sat in the armchair next to the red brick fireplace and punched in the planner's number. After 4 rings, I expected the call would go to voicemail. I was startled when a brusque voice came on the line.
Taz here.
Hello, this is Sierra Ravenswood from Flower House. Marissa Lakely asked me to give you a call. I understand you need a wedding florist.
Oh, yes. Thanks to Tammy, the diva. She made a big mistake, walking out on me like that. She just lost herself a lot of future clients. I'll never work with her again. And with my influence, neither will any other wedding planner in the state.
I was so taken aback by this unexpected outburst, I was at a loss for words. Taz didn't seem to notice.
I told Marissa I'd find another florist, but she said she wanted to go local this time. I hope you can take direction. You won't be too precious about your designs, will you? As I tried to tell Tammy, the bride is the star of the show, the flowers are the backdrop.
I understand.
Good. Be here at 6 then. I'll show you what we need.
I'm sorry, beware. He sighed impatiently.
Bellman Manor for the vendor rehearsal. We're meeting at 6:30, but if you get here at 6, that should be enough time for me to catch you up.
Okay. I think I can make that. There was silence on the other end of the line. I looked at my phone and saw that the call had ended. He'd hung up on me. Dropping my hand into my lap, I shook my head. What had I gotten myself into?
Chapter 2.
Dina and I arrived at Bellman Manor at 6 on the nose. Nestled in the hills on the outskirts of town, the private estate felt like another world. A long, tree-lined driveway led us to the expansive Tudor-style home, a 3-story brick mansion, striking with its sharp peaks and multiple chimneys. On instinct, I drove around to the back. The driveway ended at a structure that might have been another house, except for the 4 closed garage doors. To the side was a concrete pad. I parked there, in a row of other cars that clearly belonged to visitors or staff. A painted panel van featured the image of a fierce-looking rattlesnake, above the words, DJ Sidewinder, Rattler Entertainment. As we got out of the car, another van pulled up next to us. The woman who emerged wore a pale pink smock and crisp black trousers. Her brown hair was coiled in tight braids at the back of her head. When she opened the rear doors of the van and pulled out a tower of food containers, I rushed to her side. "Need some help?" She glanced at me and nodded.
"Sure, that would be great."
She handed me an insulated food delivery bag, which I passed over to Dina before accepting a covered tray. As I did so, I introduced myself and Dina. "We're from Flower House. I'm guessing you're the caterer?"
"You got it. I'm Regina Irvin."
With her arms full, she nodded her chin in greeting. "Are these refreshments for the meeting?" asked Dina.
"Not exactly," said Regina. "They're for Taz's final approval."
She pursed her lips as if she was holding back further comment. We were met at the back door by an older woman in a light blue housekeeping uniform. She took us through a short vestibule, past a sunny breakfast nook and a spacious modern kitchen, then around a corner into the great room. And great it was. I felt like I had entered a museum. Polished antique furniture gleamed along the walls, leaving open the center of the room where a massive Persian rug softened our footsteps. Far to our right was the home's entryway, a recessed area framing tall, arched double doors. To our left, a sweeping marble staircase flowed like a waterfall from a spindle-railed balcony above. My mind immediately shifted into decorating mode. The banisters begged to be draped with tulle and white roses. As we made our way across the room, I saw that the far wall showcased a carved limestone fireplace, standing regally beneath a mounted family crest. It would be the perfect backdrop for the marriage ceremony. Regina set her containers on a round table in the corner. As Dina and I took in the surroundings, I wondered where everyone else was. Although Taz had said he wanted me to arrive early, the line of cars near the back door must belong to someone. As if on cue, a side door opened, and a slender man breezed our way. Ignoring me and Dina, he addressed Regina with surprised delight, though from his syrupy tone, I couldn't tell if he was being genuine or sarcastic.
"You came. I'm honored. I thought sure you'd send one of your minions."
Leaning forward, Regina returned his air kiss with a tight smile.
"I don't think of my assistants as minions, Taz, but of course I came. You asked me to be here, didn't you?"
Taz laughed loudly.
"I could always count on you, Regina. You're a doll and a sport."
I watched the exchange with fascination. Was Taz always this patronizing, or was there a special history between him and Regina? From his appearance alone, I gathered the wedding planner was something of a character. His glossy black hair was gelled into a gravity-defying faux hawk, and his goatee was unapologetically patchy. I admired his burgundy suit. I had a penchant for bright colors myself, though even I had to admit it was a tad over the top for everyday wear. On closer inspection, I noticed the polka dots on his skinny tie were actually tiny skulls. Dina and I exchanged an amused glance. Taz eyed the food containers.
"I can't wait to taste your goodies, Reggie. Be a dear and take them to the dining room. That's where I've set up my command center."
"Of course," Regina echoed. She gathered up the containers and stalked out of the room. Dina took the tray I'd been holding and indicated with a nod that she'd follow Regina. I cleared my throat and took a step toward Taz.
"Hello, I'm Sierra."
At his blank look, I elaborated. "From Flower House, you asked me to meet you at 6 o'clock. His eyes flitted over me, from the fringe of my short hair, down my Kelly Green sweater set and brown cords, to my two-tone sneakers. His lips curled.
"I hope you can style floral arrangements better than you style yourself. You look like a tree."
My face flooded with heat. Before I could formulate a response, he glanced at his watch, a chunky gold wristband, and frowned.
"And you're late."
"I'm sorry," I began.
"Never mind, I can talk fast."
He strode across the room, obviously expecting me to follow him.
Obviously, I did.
With sweeping gestures, Taz pointed to various areas of the great room, as if he were a director on a stage. As he went over the ceremony logistics and described his vision for the proceedings, fairy tale romance meets sophisticated Gatsby-esque black tie affair, I recovered from the sting of his insult. He was probably joking anyway, right? Nobody is that mean. I peeled off my cardigan and draped it over my arm, ready to get busy. Pausing in the center of the room, Taz spread his arms wide.
"We'll have 8 rows of 10 chairs, beginning here. 5 seats on each side of the center aisle for a total of 80 chairs.
I nodded, repeating the numbers in my mind. Should I be writing this down? Surely he'd give me a checklist later. Taz moved on to the fireplace and continued talking, even more quickly.
"The 4 groomsmen will stand here, the bridesmaids here. Marky will stand there in the center. We'll have LED candles on the hearth and flowers on the mantle. I want every inch of the mantle covered with flowering vines dripping elegantly, 3 feet over the edge and spread at 6-inch intervals.
"Excuse me." I held up a hand like a pupil in a classroom. "Did you say the marquee?"
"I said marquee, as in Marquis Farrell, the efficient."
"Oh, he's not a reverend then?" Taz gave me an impatient look.
"He's a family friend, the Lakely Bellmans and the Princelys, not to mention their assorted relatives, all come from mixed religious backgrounds, hence the secular ceremony."
"Princely?" I assumed this must be the groom's name, but so far I hadn't heard a word about him. "I haven't met Marissa's fiancé yet. Is he from around here?"
"No," said Taz shortly. "Michael William Princely is not from around here, and he won't be here until next weekend. He's a political aide in Washington. Not that it should matter to you."
Aye, aye, Captain.
I shut my mouth to keep from asking any more questions Taz would deem trivial. Why is he being so mean to me?
He returned his attention to the center of the room.
A white carpet, 30 feet in length, will extend through the hall. The flower girl is 8 years old, so she can take direction. The rose petals must be dark red, think crimson, and whatever amount you imagine will be enough, triple it. Got that? Our mantra is abundance. That little girl will not run out of petals.
Okay, I'd better take notes. I reached into my purse and rifled for some paper and a pen. Finally, I found both and hastily tried to jot down Taz's instructions. To my dismay, the ink was dry. Meanwhile, Taz was still walking and talking.
The string quartet will be here. The musical director is Gordon Winslow. You may have heard of him.
I hadn't. I shook my pen in vain. Taz opened a heavy wooden door, giving me a glimpse of an elegant, formal sitting room.
The wedding party will assemble and wait in here. This is where you should bring the wearable flowers and bouquets. By 9 a.m. sharp.
He cast me a warning look.
Don't be late.
I could only stare at him in return. I didn't even know what time the wedding was scheduled to start. This guy has some nerve talking to me this way. Does he want a second florist to walk out? He turned to the staircase.
The bride will descend these steps, 18 in all, preceded by the maid of honor. I want flowing greenery along the rail and 2 jumbo vases here on the floor.
Dina walked up to us then, as Taz gave me a pert look.
Any questions?
I held up my useless writing utensil. Do you happen to have a pen?
The look he gave me could have withered a silk flower.
I felt myself blushing again, though I was more irked than embarrassed. It was no wonder the last florist quit. This guy really was not very pleasant. You'd think he'd be more gracious, considering I was stepping in so last minute. I was essentially doing everyone involved a huge favor. Before I could utter a more relevant question, a musical ringtone captured Taz's attention. He pulled a phone from his pocket and answered it. Of course, he didn't excuse himself or even step away.
Kendall, darling, where are you? Don't tell me you're going to be late for the vendor meeting. I need to go over the photo ops with you.
Dina nudged me and held out a pen.
Thanks, I whispered. Taz rubbed his forehead. Certainly there will be a photo booth. Why do you sound so surprised? I'm sure you can handle managing the booth and capturing candids of the guests.
He rolled his eyes, evidently listening to complaints on the other end of the line.
Settle down, honey. I have everything timed out. We'll talk at the meeting.
He ended the call with a sigh, then checked the messages on his phone. For a moment, he seemed to have forgotten me. I was about to speak up when he cursed under his breath.
Everything okay? I asked.
He glanced up distractedly.
Take 5, Sarah. I need to deal with something.
Sierra, I corrected.
Whatever. Listen, go take a look at the ballroom upstairs. We'll need centerpieces for every table and bouquets near the guest book and party favors, etc. After that, meet me in the dining room and I'll look at your portfolio.
With that, he slipped into the sitting room and shut the door behind him. I turned to Dina and grimaced.
That bad? She asked.
Worse, I forgot our portfolio.
In the car? She said hopefully.
I shook my head. At the shop.
I was beginning to feel this job slip through my fingers. Taz was already unimpressed with me. If he told Marissa I wasn't working out, she'd have no choice but to let him find a replacement.
I'll go get it, Dina offered.
I'm not sure there's enough time, I said. Taz seems plenty busy with other issues, she pointed out. I'm sure it won't matter if he meets with you at the end of the meeting.
I smiled gratefully. You're right. We might as well try. While Dina hurried off, I jotted down a few notes, then made my way up the marble staircase. The first landing was a large balcony-like space, beyond which was a hallway with a number of closed doors. I continued up to the third floor, where a pair of French doors opened into the ballroom. It was an enormous space, with shining parquet flooring,
gilded panel walls, and a vaulted ceiling. The room was largely empty, with the exception of a grand piano in the corner near the entrance, and a scattering of bare round tables. A large crystal chandelier hung majestically from the center of the ceiling. I whistled under my breath and dropped my sweater on a table. Walking slowly across the room, it began to sink in what a special break I'd been handed. Marissa's wedding was bound to be the fanciest, most high-profile event Aerieville had seen in a long while. Having this family on our client list and their wedding photos in our portfolio would raise Flower House's reputation like nothing else could. I'd better not squander the opportunity. As I crossed the broad floor, I realized I should have looked for a light switch. The only source of illumination was the fading sunlight streaming through four tall arched windows along the exterior wall. The effect was peaceful and slightly melancholic. Something about the long, unfamiliar shadows combined with the old-fashioned architecture and the pervasive empty silence gave the space a lonely, almost haunted feeling. I looked out the window and felt my breath catch at the panoramic view. Beyond the wooded acreage surrounding the estate rose the Smoky Mountains, sparkling in the distance. In the highest altitudes, many of the trees already showcased brilliant leaves in shades of red, orange, and yellow. Every autumn, I found myself more and more thankful to call the Appalachians my home. I felt privileged to live in such a beautiful area. But alongside the exhilaration of fall, with all its change and newness, I also felt a little wistful this time of year. It probably had as much to do with the waning summer as with an awareness of the passage of time. My birthday was coming up at the end of September. This year, I would be turning 29, which seemed particularly momentous and slightly alarming. Shouldn't I be further along life's path at this point? As the sun began its descent behind the mountains, I had a sudden realization. The loneliness I'd felt from the ballroom was really coming from me. I was missing Calvin again. What if he doesn't come back? Or what if he returns only to get his things and move away for good? After all, he wasn't from Aerieville. He had no family here, and there weren't any nearby universities if he should decide he wanted to take up teaching and research again. Why should he stay? A tinkling of piano keys intruded on my thoughts. I turned abruptly and squinted across the darkening room. "Hello?" I called. No one answered. I paced to the front of the room and located a plate of light switches. Flicking them all, I brought to life the chandelier, a hanging lamp above the piano, and several sconces along the walls. I was still alone in the room. Perhaps it had been a vibration from the floor below that tripped the piano's strings. Or maybe it was a mouse. Over the next few minutes, I used my phone to snap some pictures of the room. Then, reluctantly, I turned off the lights and headed back to the staircase. On the landing between the second and third floors, I paused to take a few more pictures of the balcony area. From the adjacent hallway, one of the closed doors opened with a soft click. I looked over to see a young man slip out of the room. His back was to me, and his shoulders hunched, as he slowly pulled the door shut behind him. For a moment, he bowed his head as if lost in thought, before turning to skulk up the hallway. When he caught sight of me, he straightened in surprise. "Oh, hey!" In a flash, the guy's somber expression brightened. He was a short man, close in height to my own 5'4" frame, with sharp features and long sideburns. He stuck out his hand. "I'm Nick Sidon, a.k.a. DJ Sidewinder. I don't think we've met." Sidewinder? Ha! Clever name. He probably meant it to sound fierce, but it sounded cute to me. I returned the handshake with a polite smile. "I'm Sierra Ravenswood, the florist." "So, Tammy really quit, huh?" "I guess so. I haven't heard the full story yet. Creative differences, I think." Nick snorted. "There were differences, but not of the creative sort." "Ah." When Nick didn't elaborate, I decided to prompt a little. I was desperate for any information that might help me get along better with the wedding planner.
I gather Taz has a strong personality. It must make it difficult for some people to work with him.
Yeah, that's one way of putting it. He knows what he wants and he's not shy about doing whatever it takes to get it. He's good at his job. Smart, too.
Have you worked with him a lot?
A few times. I've learned it's best to go with the flow with Taz Banyan. Just give him what he wants, put up with his demands, and you'll be better off in the end.
I wondered if that included putting up with his insults and condescending manner. It didn't seem right, no matter how well the job paid.
Nick looked thoughtful. Actually, I could probably learn a thing or two from Taz. He's got ambition like nobody I've ever met. Less than 3 years ago, he was mopping floors. Now he's the hottest wedding planner in the state. Been featured in national bridal magazines and everything.
Oh, wow. I had no idea. If I wasn't nervous about this job before, I was now.
We'd better not keep him waiting then. I think it's time for the meeting.
Nick checked his watch, then gestured toward the staircase.
Right. After you?
We crossed the great room at a fast clip and reached a set of partially closed pocket doors. Through the opening, I saw Regina, the caterer, sitting at a long formal dining table, chatting with two individuals I hadn't yet met, a man and a woman. On the table in front of the woman was a professional-looking camera, attached to a wide leather strap. I didn't have a chance to make any other observations before the door slid open and Taz loomed on the threshold. I cringed, half expecting him to berate us for being late. In fact, he did start yelling, but not at us.
"Where is Anton?"
he demanded, looking past us.
"He was just here. He knows I need to talk to him."
"I haven't seen him,"
Nick said mildly. To me, he said,
"Anton Cooley is the hair and makeup guy."
Taz bit the inside of his cheek, as if he was trying to decide what to do.
"Well, I need a drink," he muttered.
Nick chuckled.
"Should we break into the bar?"
Ignoring the suggestion, presumably a joke, Taz seemed to collect himself. He glanced at the cell phone he was holding, then stuffed it into his pocket and focused on Nick.
"Do you have the reception playlist?"
"Right here,"
said Nick, patting his breast pocket.
"There's been a change in plans for the first dance," Taz said briskly. "Michael William wants to surprise Marissa with a special song from their first date. You'll start out with the expected song and segue into the surprise song after they take the floor. Kendall will be ready to capture Marissa's expression."
For a split second, Nick's eyes twitched in an expression of annoyance. I wondered if it was because this change was one more in a long string of demands from Taz. Regardless, true to the DJ's earlier advice, his face quickly became passive again, and he nodded.
"Sure, no problem."
I'd been curiously watching the two men, as if I were merely a bystander. It startled me when Taz jabbed his finger my way.
"You, come with me."
While Nick went into the dining room, I scurried after Taz. He stalked into the large kitchen and gestured toward a gleaming cappuccino machine.
"Make yourself useful and brew up some coffee. God knows I'd prefer..."
He broke off abruptly as a woman entered the kitchen, her high heels clicking loudly on the tile floor. In an instant, Taz transformed like a chameleon, morphing from a gruff and uptight autocrat into a warm and friendly chum. He smiled broadly.
"Well, look at you, Miss America, dressed for the runway and radiant as the sun."
The woman smiled back. With her delicate features and expertly applied makeup, she resembled an older version of Marissa, only with shoulder-length auburn hair instead of Marissa's long blonde tresses. She wore a simple yet elegant royal blue satin wrap dress. As she approached us, she snapped closed a matching blue handbag and rolled her eyes good-naturedly.
"I'm meeting Frank and Marissa for dinner in the village. It's a nice excuse to dress up."
She swished her skirt with a laugh, then turned from Taz to me.
"Hello there. I'm Annalise."
I stuck out my hand. I'm Sierra Ravenswood, the florist. Her skin was smooth and cool, but her smile was warm.
Ravenswood, she echoed. Your family owns a little health club on the square.
That's right. Dumbbells. I cringed involuntarily. The silly name had been a source of embarrassment for me ever since I was a kid. I'd grown used to it, but I should have anticipated Taz's derisive smirk. If not for Annalise's presence, he surely would have had something insulting to say. She pulled open a drawer and removed a set of keys.
Taz, before I go, I have two updates for you. First, we received 4 more late RSVPs. I hope that won't be a problem.
Of course not. I always count on late replies.
Perfect. The second thing is a small favor, I hope. Do you think Anton will have time to do my mother's hair and makeup? She's feeling a bit left out.
He'll make time, Taz assured her. We want Grandma to be happy. No worries.
You're the best. She turned to me. He really is. I can't tell you how many crises he's averted already.
I raised my eyebrows, wondering what qualified as a crisis in the context of wedding planning. Alas, I wasn't to find out. The housekeeper entered the kitchen, carrying 2 jackets and a bulky purse. She handed one of the jackets to Annalise.
Do you need anything else, Mrs. Lakely?
Annalise accepted the jacket and slipped it on.
No, Gretchen. Go on home and have a nice evening.
To Taz, she said,
I'm not sure how late we'll be tonight. Don't feel like you need to wait up.
She gave me a pleasant nod and headed for the back door. I smiled, thinking what a nice woman she was, and what a contrast to Taz. It was too bad she was leaving. Then her last words sank in. Did she say, don't wait up? Is Taz staying here? Who knew wedding planning was a 24/7 job? Then again, if he was from Nashville, I supposed it made sense. Aerieville was a 3.5-hour drive from Nashville, as I knew well, since I'd lived in Music City myself for a time, before lack of money and prospects had forced me back to Aerieville. As soon as Annalise and Gretchen left, Taz's face hardened, and he whipped out his phone. I busied myself with the cappuccino machine, hoping its operation would be intuitive. Why couldn't they have a plain old basic coffee maker? After a moment, I opened the nearby drawers and cupboards, searching for coffee and, if I was lucky, an instruction manual. Shuffling footsteps sounded behind me as someone else entered the room. Almost immediately, Taz erupted in a frustrated tirade.
Finally, where have you been? If you want to get ahead, you have to take these jobs seriously.
I glanced over my shoulder to take a peek at the newcomer, presumably the missing Anton. He was about Taz's size, with a similarly colorful outfit. However, instead of a groomsman-like costume, he appeared to be dressed for an aerobics workout video, with paisley leggings, a long shoulder-bearing sweatshirt, and a scrunchie-tied man bun. He sauntered over to the refrigerator, a luxury stainless steel model, and perused the contents. In a soft, amusement-tinged voice, he said,
Relax, love. Just because I'm not neurotic like you doesn't mean I don't take the job seriously.
He helped himself to an apple and crunched into it with relish. Taz visibly seethed.
I wouldn't be so neurotic if you...
He broke off suddenly with a glance at me. Whatever he'd been about to say was left unsaid. Apparently, reconsidering his words, he said,
Timing is everything. You're styling the bride's grandmother now. We need to go over your schedule.
That's why I'm here, said Anton,
around a mouthful of apple flesh. He looked my way and winked. Regina rounded the corner into the kitchen and regarded the three of us with barely concealed irritation.
Are we still meeting? My samples won't stay fresh forever.
Taz turned on me and barked,
Where's the coffee?
I stammered.
Fortunately, Regina came to my rescue. Nudging me aside, she said,
Find some cups, will you?
I gladly obliged. I could have pointed out that serving coffee wasn't exactly a florist's responsibility, but at this point, I was inclined to follow the DJ's advice to go with the flow. If nothing else, this was proving to be a unique experience. It might even make for a good story someday.
Chapter 3. Seated at the dining room table, coffee cup in hand, I tried my best to blend in with the other vendors. Like them, I listened attentively and took notes as Taz ran through his master schedule, referring often to a thick leather-bound organizer. He had everything meticulously planned, from the hours leading up to the wedding and every minute of the ceremony to every moment of the reception and beyond. Based on his gravitas and hyper-attention to detail, you would have thought we were prepping for a rocket launch. In truth, I was awed by the whole process, and more than humbled to be a part of it. In the midst of my note-taking, I observed my peers around the table. What a high-level bunch of professionals. Regina, owner of her own catering company, was the picture of cool competence in her crisp pink smock and chic braids. Sitting back in her chair, she eyed Taz with a laser-like focus that showed she was all business. To the right of Regina was the photographer, Kendall. I guessed her to be in her mid-30s, though she sported a youthful appearance. She had an urban, artsy style with asymmetrical pink hair, a silver nose ring, and a black turtleneck. I recalled Taz's phone conversation with her earlier. It had seemed she was annoyed by his pile-on of her photography duties, but if she was still upset, she didn't show it. She listened passively, now and then exchanging enigmatic glances with some of the other vendors. Of course, Taz hadn't bothered with introductions. When I'd followed Regina into the dining room carrying a tray of coffee cups, I'd felt the curious stares of both Kendall and the other vendor I hadn't met yet. It didn't take me long to figure out he must be Gordon Winslow, the musical director. He rested one beringed hand on a violin case and nodded in assent when Taz mentioned the wedding march. Gordon appeared to be the oldest of everyone in the room, not only because of his thinning white hair and lined face. From his buttoned-up shirt and rigid posture, he had an air of dignity and refinement that made me feel I was in the presence of a British nobleman. I couldn't help wondering if he resented taking direction from a young upstart like Taz. Without warning, Gordon suddenly directed an icy glare toward me. Blushing, I looked away. Had I been staring? I doodled in my notebook for a moment as Taz discussed the parts of the day that wouldn't concern me, before resuming my study of the other vendors. If Gordon was the oldest, Nick must be the youngest. In contrast to the musical director, DJ Nick appeared mellow and relaxed. Well, except for a nervous twitch that sometimes pulled at the corner of his mouth or furrowed his brow. Other than the mild twitchiness, he seemed perfectly at ease, with his hands folded calmly on the table in front of him. He met my eye and, thankfully, gave me an encouraging smile instead of daggers. Speaking of relaxed, the cosmetologist, Anton, continued to display the blasé attitude he'd shown in the kitchen. The way he slouched in his chair, I half expected him to swing one leg over the arm. Like a teenager at the dinner table, he seemed to be splitting his attention between Taz and his phone. I took Anton's example as permission to sneak a peek at my own phone. What's keeping Dina? She should have been back by now. It wasn't like her to leave me hanging. Yet I had zero messages and no missed calls. Taz was describing the transition between the ceremony and the reception when Anton spoke up.
How many guests will there be?
For a moment, Taz glowered at the stylist, apparently miffed at the distraction.
As I already said, we're planning for 80. Not that it affects your job. Now then, the ushers.
Does that include the wedding party? Anton interrupted.
Why?
Asked Taz suspiciously.
I want to make sure I bring enough product samples for everyone. I'm thinking small vials of body oil and hand cream, tied up in cute little organza drawstring bags. They make perfect parting gifts.
To my surprise, Anton's statement provoked an intense reaction from nearly everyone at the table.
Several people spoke at once. That's not fair. If he gets to include advertising, how about the rest of us? At least business cards, they're small.
Taz clapped his hands sharply.
Everyone quiet. Don't be ridiculous. No one is hawking their products or services to the wedding guests. That would be beyond tacky.
He shot Anton a warning look, then resumed his presentation. Anton shrugged, and Kendall muttered something under her breath. I continued to sit quietly, like a wallflower. Ha! Wallflower. Calvin would like that one. Before long, it was clear Taz was nearing the end of his checklist, and still no word from Dina. I tapped my foot under the table in a bout of nervous energy. Any minute, I expected the wedding planner to turn on me. I just knew he was going to put me on the spot and make me feel foolish and incompetent. The second I had that thought, I checked myself. I knew better than to allow anyone to make me feel anything. I was a big believer in the power of my own attitude. If I wanted to be viewed as a professional, I should act like one. If I wanted to be treated with respect, I needed to respect myself. I sat up a little straighter and took a long, slow breath. Affirmation style. I tried on a few different statements in my mind. I am a competent person. I am a talented professional florist. I am worthy of respect. My phone buzzed, jolting me from my internal pep talk. I grabbed it from the table and quickly read the incoming text, which was from Dina. Then I read it again.
So sorry. I tried to print our latest photos and the printer ran out of ink. Then Rocky showed up with Gus, and long story short, Gus destroyed the portfolio. But I'm transferring the photos to my email so you can still show the pictures. The files are huge, so it's taking forever. I'll send them soon, I hope.
It was all I could do not to slap my forehead and groan. Gus, how could you? Actually, I couldn't be too mad at the pup. He'd been acting out ever since Calvin left. If anything, he probably missed the guy more than I did. Still, what was I supposed to do now? Somehow, I didn't think Taz would have the patience to look at our photos one by one on my tiny phone. It was too bad we didn't have an updated gallery on our website. That was another task that fell by the wayside.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.